So, good evening, everyone. Thank you all for coming. I'm Doug Roberts of PS21, Portsmouth Smart Growth of the 21st Century. If you're not familiar with us, PS21 is an independent, all-volunteer group. We host events and present ideas about planning issues in Portsmouth, including street design, parking policy, transportation, architecture, and affordable housing. Our most recent events have been about placemaking and tactical urbanism. We favor a smart growth approach, aiming to manage growth in such a way that it'll be good for the environment and good for the community. We recently became an official 501c3. We accept donations, and you can find that on our website, which is ps21.info. We also have videos of some of our past events on the website. Those events have all been recorded by Bill Rogers of Corway Film Institute, who's also recording tonight's event. We should thank our sponsors. We'd like to thank our sponsors. This project, which you're calling Vaughan Mall Green, is being supported by a grant from the New Hampshire Charitable Foundation. Additional sponsors include the Portsmouth Garden Club and Portwalk Place. PS21 season sponsors are Piscataqua Savings Bank and Martha Fuller Clark. Our event partners, Vaughan Mall, of course, is a public space, and so we're doing this in cooperation with the City of Portsmouth. We'll be providing us with both technical support and perhaps materials, depending on the results of the workshop this Saturday. Additional partners include the Seacoast Media Group, PortsmouthNH.com, and The Sound, Corway Film Institute again, 3S Artspace, Energized 360, Seacoast Local, Seacoast Peace Academy, C-Ray, the Seacoast Area Renewable Energy Initiative, and the Seacoast Permaculture Meetup Group. Three of those, the C-Ray, the Seacoast Energy Renewable Energy Initiative, Seacoast Peace Academy, and Energized 360 have tables over there. Please stop and see them. They support sustainable projects. So now Emily Corbett, who is also with PS21, will talk about tonight's event and this weekend's workshop and our speaker tonight.
Thanks, Doug, and thanks everyone for coming out tonight. It's really wonderful to see you all here. The presentation this evening is the first part of a series of events PS21 is hosting to explore more environmentally beneficial and socially engaging ways to use our public spaces here in Portsmouth. The events will culminate in an ecological placemaking demonstration project we're calling Vaughan Mall Green. This evening, Steve will be setting up the framework for this project as he describes sort of the larger context for the community planning, for community planning that is guided by permaculture, ecological design, and systems thinking. And part of the reason we had chosen Vaughan Mall Green to do this demonstration project is that it came out of our placemaking series that we had this fall, and into January. And that was the site that was chosen through that process and through the series of events that we had surrounding the placemaking topic. And so we also hope to carry elements, or we plan to carry elements that were sort of discovered through that process into the project as well, in addition to what Steve will be talking about. The second event is a workshop this Saturday, and we urge you to also attend the workshop, which would be great to see you all there. We will begin sort of directly applying the principles we'll be discussing tonight in the design for the Vaughan Mall Green project. And to register for that, please go to our website, which is ps21.info. And there is still room for a few more participants, but we do need RSVPs because lunch is going to be served, so we want to make sure we have everybody covered and nobody goes without lunch. So go ahead to the website and sign up there. The third sort of part of the of the series will be the actual implementation of the design, and that's going to be what comes out of the workshop on, that we're having on Saturday. And we will need more volunteers for that, so if you're not able to make it to the workshop for some reason, there will be more opportunities to engage with this project down the road, and we'll be figuring out what the details for that are sort of after we've had the workshop and we determine what the design will be. We'll sort of figure out what we need for volunteers and how much time that will involve. But that's slated for May 13th, so put it on your calendar now. So that's sort of a summary of all the pieces of the project here. But let's get started at the beginning. And I'm really excited to be introducing our speaker this evening, Steve Whitman. Steve is a professional planner and educator based right here in New Hampshire. His work has focused largely on community planning and sustainability issues. Steve is a certified permaculture teacher. He is also an adjunct faculty member at Plymouth State University and Colby Sawyer College. Steve frequently teaches courses in the U.S. and internationally in environmental planning, community planning, permaculture, natural building, and sustainability. Steve lives in Plymouth, New Hampshire, and participates in a wide range of grassroots efforts that promote community resilience. And so, welcome, Steve, and I'll hand it over to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Emily. I get so comfortable down there, I forgot I had to get up here. And so you're going to see me use notes tonight, which is something I often get to avoid, but this is for your benefit so that I don't go off in some other direction about something that pops into my brain. So you heard a little bit about who I am. It's really an honor to be invited into Portsmouth to be part of this conversation with such a heavy design community within the city of Portsmouth, and so many folks that are activists and designers involved with PS21, so I'm really honored to be asked here. There are a few things I wanted to share with you at the beginning of tonight's talk, and we're definitely going to have time for some discussion towards the end. So a couple things that I want you to know as we get started. The first is that I believe our towns and cities can be resilient ecosystems that provide human needs without compromising the needs of nature. I believe that being in the presence of the natural world makes us happier. It contributes to our lives in positive ways. I also believe that it takes a combination of voluntary actions and leveraging the regulatory system to get to where we want to go. And the second part is a part that's kind of lacking. It's one of the things that I'm trying to work on. And I think the voluntary action is where we see some great examples already. If we go in this direction, I think there are a lot of great yields, a lot of great outcomes that we'll experience. One of them is being here tonight with everybody and starting to brainstorm about what's possible. So what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to explain to you why I believe all of this and one way that I think we can use a system called permaculture to kind of get there. We're going to really just scratch the surface in the time that we have. So for the next 5 hours, right. Now in like the next hour, like start flashing the lights if we start approaching an hour. Okay, so what are you in for? What I'd like to do is move right on to what I see as the problem. From there, we'll talk a little bit about what ecological design is, what permaculture is as one framework for approaching an ecological design. We'll talk a little bit about how we start to understand our site, and so that's for those of you who maybe tonight is the only part of the series you're going to go to, and you want to start thinking about your own homes. Spring has sprung, somewhat reluctantly maybe, but as you start to think about what's happening on your own property, or if you do decide to come back on Saturday or the following time and participate, I want to give you a sense of how we're going to use a design process. We're going to do an interactive exercise, which will be painless. It'll be fun, where you get to be the critics. And then we'll just wrap up with some discussion. So I wanted to define the problem, and I figured I would use a beautiful picture to do so. The problem as I see it is that there are several problems, I'm sure. But the one problem that exists that I wanted to identify is that when we plan for our communities, it's often easy to create a beautiful vision of the future, right? So a lot of times in a master plan or some kind of planning process, we can have a really bold vision. Unfortunately, it's not often quite this bold. Maybe some of you don't want it to be this bold either, and that's fair. But we can often go into the visioning direction. We can talk about our aspirations for the community. Sometimes we're afraid to aim this high. Sometimes just that is too much of a shift for us collectively as a community. But all too often, where I think we fall down, the problem I see is that we don't follow through with whatever the vision is that we've created. We talk about it, we say what it's going to be, but then actually to lay the groundwork, whether it's budgetary or whether it's policy, or just continuing the conversation, having the energy for volunteers and, you know, municipal decision makers to participate is often where we run into problems. I think we also run into problems because we maybe don't want to face some of our assumptions, and maybe we're a little afraid of shifting paradigms or revealing our own paradigm is shifting and that we see new possibilities. And what I think is possible is that we can have the vision and then we can actually act on it, and that's what we're going to talk about tonight. Because when we don't, this is what we get. In a lot of communities, these are not pictures from Portsmouth. I was smart enough not to do that. But what we tend to get when we don't act on that vision is we get something that's been fragmented, that probably doesn't even fully meet our current needs, and definitely isn't thinking as long-term as PS21 and other organizations are trying to. There's a real disconnect between the vision and our actions. So, what if every land use change that happened in your community made the community more resilient? What if it contributed to the community in a real thoughtful way, and really contributed to that vision that you had? Unfortunately, what we tend to see is every land use decision takes away. We kind of know that we're going to give up something, we're going to lose something with every development that happens. So we're trying to shift that paradigm. And this is where I see the greatest potential for taking a more ecological design approach, really taking a more systems perspective, maybe moving a little bit slower and getting to know our sites a little bit better. And that's both at both scales, at your own individual site level as well as participating across your community. I have a note at the bottom for myself to slow down, but I think I'm all right. So you're probably wondering, or you probably have your own definition, which is fair as well, what is ecological design? So in its simplest form, it's a design process that recognizes the importance of the natural, the built, and the social infrastructures that we have in our communities. It engages us in a thoughtful pursuit of adaptive, resilient, and even regenerative design solutions. It's nature-driven, but not exclusively nature-oriented. We have certain human needs we're trying to address. We have economic needs. We have competing interests, maybe, that we're trying to compromise on in our communities. So when I say it's adaptive, I like to point out the fact that natural systems are adaptive, much more than a lot of our human-made systems are. They have the ability to adapt to change in situations, change in need. And I think we probably want the same from the built environment, from our own communities. We want to be thinking about how we can make them more adaptive over time. And this is something that I think a lot of our current developments do lack. Natural systems regenerate. So we create systems, natural systems tend to be able to restore, renew, revitalize. They can provide their own source of energy, their own materials. That's not necessarily the way we approach built systems and thinking about how will energy be cycled, how materials be cycled, how does the system become stronger, more sustainable over time. So previously developed sites can play a role in this too. So knowing that we're in an urban situation and we're looking at Vaughan Mall on Saturday, thinking about how we can also regenerate ecosystem services, something we'll talk about tonight, restore some of the ecological values that have been lost but can be brought back. And I think these principles are something that's really in line with a community that sees itself as an eco-municipality that's using the natural step as a process. And natural systems are much more resilient than our human-made systems that give us something to aim for. We may not be able to make our own communities and downtowns as resilient as a natural system, but it's something that we can strive for. It can be part of our vision. Being resilient has the ability to, a system has the ability to bounce back from an outside shock. I don't know any of the 234 communities in New Hampshire that aren't constantly being challenged with outside shocks, whether they are political shocks, funding shocks, ecological shocks. We're all dealing with change on a constant basis. So how do we provide that safety net, that resilience within those communities? So here I think it's important in thinking about ecosystem design to think about some important design considerations that we can learn from natural systems. The first one is that nature runs on sunlight. The second is that nature uses only the energy it needs. Nature fits form to function. Nature recycles everything. Nature rewards cooperation. Nature banks on diversity. Nature demands local expertise, and sometimes a guy from Plymouth, New Hampshire. And nature curbs excess from within. So just thinking about some of the inherent design elements of a natural system can help maybe change the way that we look at our systems and our communities. So that brings us to this. This idea of ecological services, ecosystem services. And I wanted to use this tonight to help you kind of look at the whole idea of ecological design in a different way and help you break down what it is that I'm talking about. So the graphic you'll see here has four different types of services that are provided. All too often when we look at how our communities approach land use change, we tend to see maybe one of these quadrants. And usually it's the one that has to deal with stormwater, a really important aspect of incorporating green infrastructure and ecosystem services, but definitely only one of many that we can benefit from. So we have four categories of services provided. When I talk about wanting to go beyond green infrastructure, I'm going to refer back to this diagram, and we'll bring it back at the end. But the whole idea is that each of the things we're doing could have multiple functions, which is very much a permaculture approach, like try to get as many functions out of each design element, and can satisfy a broader set of services than maybe we've tried to with ecological design or with green infrastructure in the past. I have not been before a planning board that has considered cultural services yet. I look forward to that day when they want to know how, you know, Vaughan Mall makes people feel spiritually. But I think that inherently a lot of us know that. We're attracted to those places. So maybe we can recognize it's there, even if it's not on a checklist, you know, for site plan yet. The other thing I wanted to point out here is that we're talking about lots of different scales. So whatever scale you're picturing, your site, your neighborhood, your town, your region, they're all relevant. They may have different goals that you're intending, but in some cases, we're looking landscape-wide. We're looking across, you know, municipal boundaries, and we're thinking about parks and open spaces and stream buffers and wetlands and protecting things that are, for the most part, intact natural systems. And then we can also be looking at how do we direct redevelopment, regeneration of somewhat developed or heavily developed sites at the same time, down to the site level. So moving from gray to green infrastructure, I think I got about 8 or 9 slides into this, and I was really happy with myself. It was kind of like what I would want to listen to. And then I thought, I wonder if people know what green infrastructure is. And I wonder if they've even stopped to think about the fact that we have lots of different, there's a gradient from gray to green infrastructure. So I thought I would put up a slide and talk about it for a second. The one way I see gray infrastructure, the image on the left, is it's very transactional. We're trying to move things away. We're trying to move people. We're trying to move water. We often externalize the cost, the actual cost, damage to the environment, or the transfer of pollutants or whatever it may be. But it's become very common. It's become what we're familiar with. It's become kind of fail-safe to use it. And so how do we move towards the green infrastructure side? There's a divide. There are lots of different design professionals that can all contribute pieces of it. I don't have all the answers, but this is a place where we use that natural rule of cooperation, that collaborative space, to try to figure out what the solutions are. But I think it's worthwhile that we start to move in that direction. Green infrastructure, I think, better integrates and addresses the needs of the site and people on the site, as well as people downstream, so to speak. It takes responsibility for what's happening on site. It decentralizes treatment. It provides habitat and lots of other ecosystem functions, maybe even the spiritual side of things. And really, the aim is at creating a more complex and supportive system. Downtowns, villages, cities, they're complex ecosystems. I think all too often we try to strip them down and simplify them for our own benefit. But I think we could probably complex them a little bit. We'll see if the word complexing takes on. So, in thinking about green infrastructure, I thought it was also important to point out that there are a few problems with green infrastructure. And that these are things that we should go into knowing all too well for Saturday, and not just think that we can, you know, put plants everywhere and the problem's going to be solved. There are a lot of site-specific considerations that can be a challenge, but one of the biggest ones I thought of is it's not used enough. It's not something that we have a lot of experience with still, especially here in the Northeast. We have some great examples of some really good projects that maybe haven't had a lot of time yet. It's something we need to be doing more of and learning and changing and adapting over time. The examples we do have tend to be voluntary. They tend to be that one business or that really inspired designer that just goes above and beyond and does something because they think it's the right thing to do or the client is in support of it. And they also tend to be separated from other site elements. So your drainage should happen over there, your landscaping should happen over here, pedestrian access happens over there. So what if we start to integrate them a little bit better? And maybe we provide some flexibility to the site designers and to the developers to better meet their own objectives on their sites. So I want to get beyond that kind of single function element as well, that it's just stormwater oriented, or it's just heat island effect oriented, or it's just air quality oriented. We should be able to hit lots of different ecosystem functions with the same plant or the same rain garden, whatever the design solution may be. Okay, I have no idea what's going to happen now. Oh, I do. So, a case study example. I hesitated to just throw lots of examples at you because I didn't, on Saturday, want you to just be stuck with examples in your head if you decide to come back. So I wanted to give you a little bit more to think about so you could come with questions and your own thoughts on Saturday. But I thought there were a couple good examples that were worth sharing. So this is from Montreal. This is a map of green spaces, existing green spaces and parks, future areas that are going to be converted to green space. It's kind of taking a landscape view of the city, right? What I find really interesting here is that they're looking at these connections between green spaces as ways of contributing to mobility, how you move around the city, contributing to a reduction in vehicle trips, making it easier to walk and bike around the city. So there are lots of objectives they're going after. Restoring ecosystem services, and overall restitching the natural systems within the city. One of the ways they're doing it is through green alleys. So they have a green alley program, and I have to go back up to Montreal now and take my family on the green alley tour. It'll be their favorite family vacation of all the places I've taken them. But you can actually go on a green alley tour in Montreal. And they all have a different character. And so they have mapped it. It has come voluntarily from participants, the bordering property owners, working with the city. But I thought this was a really fun strategy. It's a really fun case study that's in line with a lot of the work that you're doing here in Portsmouth and is inspiring and is equally cold and, you know, all those challenges we get. Well, it snows here and plants die. Yes, they do, but they come back. When we think about ecological design, I think we can also think about humans in the design process, even little humans. This is at a school. On the right is a sidewalk, like a public sidewalk. This is in the city. It's in Portland, Oregon. This is part of the playground, which is an edible playground. It rains in Portland, so there are some roof structures so people can get outside. But I thought this was a really nice way to talk about thinking about how to incorporate people into the site conditions and into the culture of a place, and then working that into the final product. It can be done lots of different ways, but the idea being, similar to Vaughan Mall, providing a place where people can gather, but maybe in close proximity to natural features, where they can get some of the benefit of the biophilia, that kind of human biological interaction between plants and people. Even if they're not aware of all the ecosystem services that are being provided through cleaning water and cleaning air and providing habitat and providing food and other things, it's important to their health. They'll be gravitating to these places just subconsciously, intuitively. And the other thing that's great about doing this is that it provides a place for people to naturally connect, which is one of the things we're trying to do. We're trying to bridge social connections. We're trying to contribute to the social capital of a wonderful downtown that has a lot of places where you can do that. And I know some of you are not from Portsmouth, so I want to make sure that we're including that and getting you to think about your own communities. And some of these are kind of funky, right? Placemaking, tactical urbanism, ecological design, the combination of the three, whatever approach we decide to take, we want to be thinking about how we can make these even small places more resilient, more adaptive, applying to many people's needs, and being places that people care about. So this is a T station in a neighborhood. It provides that one place where all the neighbors can come and kind of hang out and meet up with other neighbors, and not just on Facebook. So a place for human interaction. These places can reflect a lot about us and the personality of the place that we live. Or we can go back to this. Raise your hand if you just like to stick with this. We could end right now. I'll meet you at the bar. I'll need to meet you at the bar, I think. I think we can be more creative than this. We may still need some of these systems. We're dealing with bigger rainstorms. We're dealing with a changing climate. It's not that in some cases we have these systems in place and they can be part of our redundancy to make sure that if the new systems we're contributing to the landscape fail or can't handle the changing environment, that there's not a catastrophic failure. So these can be our backup. And we can do this. Has anyone been to New York City in the recent past? I mean, New York City, huge change. Washington, D.C., change in lots of ways, but change physically. Paris, the picture on the right is Paris. So if these major metropolitan places that have, you know, we have the images of the architecture and the land use patterns in our brains, even if we've never been there, we've been kind of inundated with images of these places. If they can change, small towns in New Hampshire can change. We probably have a couple of the key decision makers here tonight. We could probably make a decision tonight, bring it to city council, and move on. But we have that ability. We're in a small state, you know, and we're in small communities, and we do participate. You know, a lot of us are actually part of organizations like PS21 or sitting on planning boards and conservation commissions. So I think we have this. We can do it. All right, so maybe this is what brought you out tonight. I don't know. What is permaculture? It takes a long time to figure out what permaculture is. I see some smiling faces in the audience from some of my permaculture friends. It's something that I've been working on for now 17 years. I think I'm just starting to get it. I mean, I think I'm gonna spend the rest of my life trying to figure out what it is and how I can apply it, because it changes and I change. But I'll try to break it down for you in the not 100-hour version. So if ecological design is our goal, I think permaculture is one way to get there. Before I fell in love with permaculture, and it stole me away from my family for a while, I was really enamored with the natural step. So I actually taught a natural step course. I took students from Plymouth State to Sweden. I talked to people here in Portsmouth who were part of setting up the whole process here of becoming an eco-municipality. I was pretty jazzed about the natural step, and I still am. I think it's wonderful. For me, the limitation was I wanted something, a tool, selfishly, as a homeowner that I could use at that scale, that I could use for actually like site planning and decision making at the site level. And then as a planner, I wanted something I could bring into communities. And as they think about planning for a site, the future safety service building, or they think about their master plan, I wanted a process I could go through that was maybe more linear. So it might be my personality. But I wanted something that gave me a little bit more than the four system conditions of the natural step. And that's when I found permaculture. So permaculture basically is a design process. It's a framework that we can use. And it's inherently designed to take an ecological bent and a human social bent. It also encourages us to do collaborative design, to not be alone. Some of my worst design decisions have been when I've been working and I thought I was at my most brilliant and I showed my family and they pointed out how I'd forgotten about them. So some of my best design times were probably with Sophie and other people that are here. So in thinking about using the permaculture process, we think about the human participants, but it really pushes us to observe more deeply, to spend more time understanding what our goals are for the site and understanding the site itself. It requires us to think about the needs of natural systems, other humans, and our own ability to contribute over time. It takes a slow approach. Not everybody likes that. Homeowners hate it. I mean, if I get a call for a design consultation, the house is usually built, they've picked out the paint color, and they're looking to just do permaculture in the yard, and the house might be in the wrong spot. So people hate that. They don't want to know the house is in the wrong spot, and they didn't need a septic system. But it's a way of breaking down a design process, moving with more intention, and it gives you the ability to take these discrete steps but keep a systems perspective. So to step back occasionally and see the interconnections between things, which I find really, really helpful. It also, over time, in working with permaculture, this is not the only slide I have, it allows you to give up a little bit of the ownership as a designer or as somebody who's taking action. And this took me a while, but it allows you to give up a little of that and step back and observe how nature co-creates with you over time. Because some of the most brilliant things that get plugged into a permaculture design are the things that occur when you've made the conditions right for them to happen. So if that was too long of a definition, this is a really short one that I like. That it's a sustainable design system, stressing the harmonious interrelationship of humans, plants, animals, and the earth. It's the type of thing that I can feel good being part of professionally and personally, and it really drives the type of work that I want to do, and I think it's really in line with the work that you're doing here in Portsmouth and the work you've been doing for many years as an eco-municipality. So the backstory is that the strange word permaculture, permanent agriculture, or permanent culture, actually came from two folks in Australia in the 1970s. But it didn't just appear out of thin air. It was based on their awareness of how indigenous people had lived within their ecosystem, as participants in their ecosystem and in harmony with their ecosystem for many, many thousands of years on the planet. It was also a fact they were inspired by early ecologists and conservationists. They were inspired by perennial agriculturalists and by systems thinkers. And they just kind of saw all these points of light and brought them together and gave it a name and started to put some structure behind so that people would come together and contribute to it. It's only about as old as I am. So as a design approach, it's very young. I always tell students they can take it in directions it's never gone. We see it changing on an annual basis as more and more people bring their own skill set and interest to permaculture. So a couple of things I think I would add. Similar to the natural step, which has those four system conditions, permaculture has three ethics and a series of principles. And so they give you some structure. The thing that won me over most was that permaculture is inherently solution-oriented. I was about ready to give up. I mean, things are not really great on the planet. And then I went and had kids, and I think I made it worse, and I felt bad for them. And you can get into that kind of downward spiral of just seeing how bad things are and feeling like there's nothing you can do to reverse the trends. Permaculture doesn't allow that. There are some people in permaculture that are like that, but it's solution-oriented. Is one of the sayings is that the problem is the solution. It gives you a chance to step back when you see a problem and really think about what is going on and what solutions may actually be present within that area. So permaculture allows us to embrace the complexity of ecological design. It pushes us to shift our thinking, to step out of the situation. And it's inherently coming from an abundance perspective. You're not going to be a very good designer, and you're not going to find a lot of folks that want to collaborate with you if you're always coming at things from a reductionist, fear-based perspective. So it's a lot about rolling up your sleeves, getting together with people, putting in the work to find the solutions, which makes it a lot of fun. The other thing I think that's nice about it related to ecological design is it sees complexity and redundance in the system as a strength. We try to strip a lot of that out, and then we have these systems that fail. And so over time, I think using this as a tool just to raise questions and get us to collaborate could actually make our designs more resilient. The real value in permaculture is not the name. It's not in the ethics and principles. It's not in even taking a design course. It's in valuing the process that you go through, whether it's for a container garden on the back deck for the summer, which is like your first, like the first thing I ever did was like a 4x8 raised bed. I was like the proudest person in the world. And I still think it was a great thing that I was able to do. Whether it's at that scale or whether it's those of you that are coming together to restitch the systems in the city, it's the process you'll go through with each other, and it's the way your perspective will shift. I think that is the greatest thing. Some of you will get to experience this a little bit on Saturday with kind of our rapid fire assessment and design brainstorming. But what it does is it makes you step back and leave your designs and all your great ideas that you may have walked in with behind, and actually peel back the layers of the site and get to know each individual layer of the site really, really well, which tends to raise more questions and things you need to figure out. And it forces us to ask those questions, come back and do more observation, and put in the time before we craft solutions. And it's one of those things that it gets better with practice. So the pictures on the left are from Franklin, New Hampshire. It's one of a couple of examples I'll just highlight tonight. We went through this process, it was a week. We spent about a week on this. So like the 4 or 5 hours you may spend with me on Saturday, it's gonna be no problem. Picture spending a week, like 7 in the morning to like 11 at night. It was not even enough time. We were dealing with a bigger site than we're gonna deal with on Saturday. But the site analysis process starts with knowing what the scope of your area is, what's your site map, and then going through observation and analysis of a series of different layers of information which are listed on the right-hand side. I won't read them to you. This same process can be used at different scales. It can be used in totally different geographic and cultural settings. It's a process that we'll use on Saturday. It's a process I used with Plymouth State students last week. It's a process I used in Belize in March. I've used it in Africa, in Haiti, in other places. It's relatively simple. We use really basic tools, markers, pens, trace paper. You don't have to be able to draw more than a stick figure. I'm not an artist. And it's really more about participating in the process. And we have great artists that will help us put things pen to paper. So we'll work on that. Another important step in the permaculture design process is what we call goals articulation. It's really the setting of the goals. What are your intentions for the site? And it's kind of an iterative process. We start with it early on, and we tend to come back and revise. But one of the goals is to come up with a statement that just gets you really excited about the potential for the site, similar to how a community develops a vision for the master plan to guide itself. We create a kind of a mini vision for the site, for the intentions of the design. So the pictures on the right, these are both from a building called Riverbend Mill. It's on the Winnipesaukee River, downtown Franklin. I had been part of two charrette efforts for downtown Franklin before we did the permaculture charrette, and the building had been in the same condition. It had been basically underutilized, a lot of deferred maintenance. It's a big rambling building along the river in really rough shape. What we did was not figure out the actual reuse of all the buildings. We didn't punch a lot of numbers. I have a tendency to give people no budgetary restrictions. And then we kind of try to figure out what it is we're trying to do, and then we can work backwards from there. What this design process did was it got people to see Franklin in a whole different light. It got them to see what it could look like if you brought ecosystem services back in. If you addressed all the places where the vegetation had been stripped off and the soil had been compacted and in some cases polluted, if you thought about bringing life back into this small city. And the design you see in the lower part of the screen is just for 4 acres of that whole downtown. And it won't look like that when it's done. That wasn't the intent. But it was to get people to start to recognize the abundance and the opportunity that things like water present, that they're not just a challenge or a problem, that they're real opportunities to envision the city quite different. This project is really moving forward. You can actually find out more about it if you want to look on. They have a website for the nonprofit, Perma City Life, and they have little project updates, kind of case study updates of what's going on. It's brought businesses back into the downtown. This is a really struggling downtown. I won't go too far into it. Some of you have probably been reading news about Franklin for a while. But it also has a state route through it and a tremendous amount of traffic. People that hadn't been stopping who now may have a reason to stop. And Riverbend Mill is part of a $11 million redevelopment for workforce housing right now. So big projects are starting to happen. Not just elderberries and high bush blueberries. Like really big projects, which is good. And I feel that we played a role, as you will, in just getting the conversation started and kind of shaking people out of, you know, what their expectations were for the downtown and all of its problems, and getting them to take more of an abundance perspective and to see the possibility to accommodate everybody in that. All right, so I want to check my time because I'm going to have you do an exercise. Perfect. Okay, so I'm going to go to the next slide. What we're going to do is I'm going to have you look at the image. A couple of you have seen this image, so you're not allowed to comment. What I want you to do is take a look at the image, take a couple minutes, talk to your neighbor, especially if it's not someone you know. Like, turn around, talk, make noise, like, get really rowdy. I'll bring you back. But look at the image and just make some observations about what's going on and questions that you have. So take a couple minutes. I'll move out of the way. You guys are way too well behaved. I see a lot of finger pointing. You guys are figuring this out. Who wants to share some of their observations? Yes, you, ma'am. All right, so this woman, Jen, said they're not harvesting the rainwater correctly. So what do you mean? Where's the rainwater going, Jen?
Going out, and they're watering it with a hose.
They're watering it with a hose. Okay. What else did you guys see? What other observations?
The rainwater's picking up the fertilizer and all the dirt from the sidewalk and into the street and down to the drain and going into the bay.
Absolutely. Yeah, away, right? Yeah. What else did you see? Yeah, please. Yeah.
Could there be an obstruction of the sidewalk?
with the material that's washing on there?
Sure.
Yeah. Hazard to skateboarders. Right. Sarah, what'd you say? So they're bringing nutrients in the form of fertilizer, bringing all the biomass away in yard scraps. Anything else that you see?
Very linear.
Very linear thinking?
Yeah.
Old school. Yeah. All right. Yeah.
Impervious surfaces.
Yes, there's a few, huh? Which ones do you see?
Sidewalk, the street, the roof.
So you get a bunch of impervious surface. And there's no relationship between that impervious surface and other things that are going on. All right, so we're going to go to, this is the before. Let's go to the after picture, see if you notice any changes. And you can talk to each other for a minute, but. All right, so what changed? You're smart people. What do you see? Does it look different? A little bit, yeah, a little bit. Think about when we talked about ecosystem services, maybe what services have returned or what systems have been. We have birds. Yeah, there were no birds or insects in the previous photo, right? What else?
No hose.
The hose is sleeping. Yeah, the hose is asleep. Yeah. What else? Yeah, the water, the path to the trees has been opened up. The trees look healthier. Yeah.
More diverse vegetation.
Yes, absolutely. It's what?
I said it's Portland.
No, it's actually Tucson, Arizona, but yeah. Yeah, his information's at the bottom. Do you see anything else that's different, a relationship that's changed with impervious surfaces?
The direction of water.
Where's the water going, Chris? Right. Correct. Oh, off the property, right? So in this case, what they did was they modified the infrastructure, right? They cut the curb, and they started to bring water in. So really started to see, even though it was water from the road, like, ooh, what a bad thing, water from the road. Somebody's going to take advantage of that. Someone's going to provide the space and the time for that dirty storm water to actually get clean. And so they incorporated that into the space between the sidewalk and the road. Yes?
Can you show us the previous slide again?
Absolutely.
Appreciate
yep.
Thank you.
It looks so sad now compared to the...
It doesn't appear to be a hugely expensive change.
No. Exactly. That's a really good point. Yeah. So really small change, and you could have started with just one of these if you weren't sure, right? And just incrementally made a small part of your yard a little bit different, watched it, learned from it, made changes to it. Yeah. All right. So now that you have kind of your designer eye, your observation eye, I'm going to give you another photo. This one's going to hit a little closer to home. But see what you notice in the next photo. This is to kind of hook you, hopefully, for Saturday.
Whoa.
You can talk to your neighbors again. Okay, so I have a couple of questions. I want to hear about your observations, but a couple of questions to kind of seed the conversation too. One of them is a fair question. What don't you know from this one photo? You may have more questions than observations, and that's fair. So you can just throw out questions as well. What would you like to know? But what ecosystem services do you think might be provided already that might be intact that we want to be thinking about? And what's missing? Observations. What comes to mind? Yeah.
I think everything is missing for the Vaughan Mall. I don't think there's anything in place that would be conducive to what we're talking about tonight.
Okay.
Right now, I actually am representing a business currently in the Vaughan Mall tonight, and we're excited that PS21 has chosen the Vaughan Mall as
cool.
a project, and we're looking forward to working with you and totally excited about everything I'm hearing tonight.
Awesome.
So thank you. And it's a dead space right now in Portsmouth, and I think Portsmouth has kept it a dirty little secret for far too long, and it's time to move on.
We're shining a light on it.
So thank you.
You're welcome. I feel like I'm playing a really small role, but I appreciate your enthusiasm. Yeah.
It's a start, Steve, and we have to start somewhere.
Yep.
And Vaughan Mall is a hidden jewel that Portsmouth could be proud of, but right now it's a secret, and everything that I'm hearing tonight is very conducive, I think, in revitalizing the Vaughan Mall. Thank you.
Cool. Thank you.
And Steve, you also said small steps are crucial.
Totally.
Yeah,
and small steps, thanks, Chris. Small steps are crucial. Some of the steps that you might come up with to take this first summer could also be small. They could also be experimental. They could inform future designs and big changes, because it is a big space, right? What other things do you see that are positive or show opportunities for the future?
Trees.
There are some huge trees there, right? Now, they cast a lot of shade. But they are some pretty amazing trees. What else? What about the parking lot?
It's a hub. It's a node. A lot of people go through there. It's an alleyway that provides access.
Okay. Yeah, so it's an asset. It could be perceived as a problem, but it might be part of the solution to bringing people in.
There have been talks to make that parking lot into a park.
Okay.
I don't know if that's still in the works with the town, but from what I heard about 2 years ago, that was in the effect.
Okay. Yeah.
There's a lot more space that's unused than is needed.
Okay.
There's a lot of opportunity for the greenscape to go in and not impede traffic.
There's a lot of, because a lot of it's impervious surface now just for pedestrians, but maybe more than they need? Okay.
Yeah.
What else are people seeing? I'm sorry if I don't see you because I'm blinded. That's a great question. That's not something I could have answered, but does anybody know if it's ever been an access?
It was an access road years ago, and it's actually in talks with its town council to actually make it that way again, because they actually want to take Congress Street and make it two-way again. And so there's talks to make the Vaughan Mall a road access from the other side of the street. So, I don't know.
This is good. We're learning. Yeah, in the back. Right.
You see, in this particular view, there's not a whole lot of reason to stay here.
Right.
It's not inviting, it's not a place that you want to see. But we've been talking about the trees. There are some good bases to pivot off of. We're not talking about the derelict mountain.
Yeah, I would totally agree. And there, I would also point out, the storm drain's there intentionally to attract your eye. But that means that there are also some systems in place that are good backup systems. They're already there. We could try to make it so that maybe some of the water doesn't get to those drains, or it only gets to them when it's really an issue. Yes?
When that was done, I don't know, 30 or 40 years ago, it was a minor miracle that it went from being a street to what it is.
Okay.
We could look at it in 2017 and say, why didn't they do this, why didn't they do that?
Sure. Right.
And we look at the vertical granite curbing, which keeps the water out, but it also keeps the snow plows out. And would the trees still be alive they weren't protected. Maybe you could use a metal grate or something, but
right.
That's a major problem with snow plows. When they do the snow removal operation at 3 o'clock in the morning, the guys have been plowing for 24 hours.
Sure.
And more trees probably have been lost that way. And I don't know, the granite curbing also keeps the salt out, so I don't know how you balance getting a natural runoff in there without the sodium.
It raises a lot of questions. For one thing, we'd want to look at how much is used on this surface and how much of that salt-laden water we're trying to put into a small area for treatment versus spreading it out into more vegetated areas than exist now. And then what kind of organic material we're using, what kind of maybe salt-tolerant plants we're also considering and contributing to the site. So it raises a lot of design-related questions. And then, you know, are there some other materials we can use as well? And it could be experimental. You do one and see how it goes over a couple of seasons. I think what you raised a couple of really helpful points. One is to remember the history, the initial conversion to a pedestrian mall and the difficulty that that presented to actually get the space for people to be able to pass through. And then how can we build on that? And how can we address some of these known design challenges? And I think we can. Has anybody looked at the potential for green roofs on some of those?
Well, I own one of the buildings, and it's a wood frame structure in the roof.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure it would support a green roof. They're big, big, huge beams, but they're interspersed. There's 10 of them going across.
Right. It's where that's when we need a structural engineer where that adds to the permaculture process but can provide the answers that you would need as a building owner. So I have another picture, equally stunning, but we don't have to beat this to death. The intent is on Saturday to spend some time, as you already have, starting to ask questions, starting to think back how the space has been used over time, what's worked well, because I'm sure there are some things that have worked really well in the space and we want to draw those out. We don't want to make changes that are going to negate what's already working, but how could we improve it? So that'll be the fun part post-lunch on Saturday. We'll be getting to how we can actually improve it, kind of starting that process. And what we're going to try to do on Saturday to bring this all kind of to a close, it's thinking about how we started and thinking about ecosystem services earlier and how we want to communicate that being the driver behind our design process. We want to look at how we can consider things like food production in a different way in urban environments. None of these are pictures of what's going to happen at Vaughan Mall. I'm not that bold. But thinking about things like food production, is there a way to incorporate food production? It doesn't work in every site, but it's one of the many provisioning services that we can provide. Thinking about nutrient cycling and habitat creation. People have been to the... Yeah, if you can do that on an old railroad, you know, raised up in New York City, you can do some interesting things. Thinking about the spiritual and recreational services provided by these spaces, the aesthetic benefits in those cultural services, and thinking about climate regulating, water, and air purification services provided by the other regulating services on a site. So, kind of using this image to come back to what else could we do? Or how else could we make this design even better and incorporating even more things into a really small space, even if it's just to the initial pilot location for the design? So what I will tell you is that aside from what you're trying to do, there are a lot of people that are using an ecological design approach and using permaculture in lots of creative ways. And I didn't provide you with lots of case study examples. I'll hit on a couple others. This is because I gave you an urban example with Franklin. I thought I'd give you a suburban and a rural example. So this is a suburban example from Pelham, New Hampshire. It's a project that's gone through initial permitting. The town's excited. DES is excited. It's all about getting the numbers to work to keep the units affordable. And so they're going through that process right now and making some changes to the unit layout. But basically, what we were able to do with this one design is accomplish the goals of the town master plan and regulations as far as some open space conservation. We had to play around with some really archaic dimensional regulations that we were being held to. So that drove some of the design. But stacking a lot of the shared functions of food production, habitat creation, heating and cooling for the homes, communal space for the homeowners, and relatively small, high efficient homes on the site. And it's a really different model. I really irritated the site engineer when we got brought on to help kind of take a more permaculture approach. All the regulators, local and state, were quite happy because it meets a lot of the objectives that we're setting out to meet. And this is a really recent project in Hebron, New Hampshire. This is a more regenerative project. It's a 2-acre site. It's a former marina. If you've ever gone boating on Newfound Lake, there was a marina at the north end of Newfound Lake. It was purchased after it had gone into default. All the buildings were taken down, and basically all the areas where you see pathways and trees and buildings, that's all just hard-packed gravel. It's like a post-industrial wasteland, 2 acres of it, right on the lake. It was gifted to a conservation organization, the Newfound Lake Region Association. We had a group of students come in and do initial site assessment for the 2 acres. Then we had lots of community meetings and public participation. And this is just the first design. So now we're working with DES on some shoreline restoration that needs to happen, and there's some more design process that needs to happen before they decide how they're going to proceed. But really, really exciting, looking at how they could accomplish lots of goals that the organization had, but then other goals the community has introduced. And then in kind of wrapping up for the night, I would say experiment. The most I have learned has been in working on my own site. We've been on our site in Plymouth for 15 years. It's only a half acre. We have tried all kinds of things, and the system has gotten so much stronger than when we got there, and it was just, a little 1890s house and a lot of lawn. There's a tremendous amount of biodiversity. I'm almost at that point where I could just, wear a loincloth and walk around and pick up food. But my wife won't let me wear a loincloth in the neighborhood. But we've been able to restore a lot of ecosystem function on the site. It's made it a joyous place. I feel like right now, all my friends are coming back. They're all coming up out of the ground, and there's new friends, and a couple of friends have gone. But it's a really cool process. And it's the process, as I said earlier, where you find that you're a co-creator. You're only part of it. And a lot of it is also setting your ego aside and stepping back and being in observation mode and being willing to learn so the continued learning happens. So in closing, I would just say, as you work to improve Portsmouth, or if you're from another community, that community, consider the goals. Look for an abundance of ecosystem services at whatever scale you're working at. How much activity can you encourage in that space? Aim really high with your vision, but follow through with your action, because the vision really needs to be followed through with as much intensity in the implementation phase. Otherwise, we don't really get anywhere. And with that, I'm going to hand things back over to someone from PS21, and then I think we're going to move on to some questions. Did they all leave? Oh, no. Doug, I see you.
So people with burning questions, raise your hand, and we'll pass the microphone around.
Okay, so we've touched on a few things tonight, and a couple of things that me and my partner at the current Vaughan Mall location are wondering: are we looking at more of an open air situation, or the Faneuil Hall in Boston, or are we looking at something that you touched on a little earlier about an edible mm-hmm. situation. What are we looking at here in Portsmouth? I mean, I think it's very exciting. We're very excited. And just trying to figure out what direction we're heading in that aspect.
I have those same questions. I hadn't considered something like Faneuil Mall. This really is a process that the design ideas have to come out of all of you. So from you folks, from like a business perspective and as abutters to the property, to other folks that decide to participate Saturday or in the days that follow, it really needs to be generated by what you think would work there once you know the site. And so getting other people up to speed on the site so they feel comfortable that they can talk about what's going on there and how it could be improved will be important, but I don't...
Yeah, I've heard a lot of that.
Well, and it'll be good at some point on Saturday to bring a lot of those ideas and just get them all up so that people can decide which ones they feel they're going to gravitate to and how it may phase over time. So, because it'll change, right? Some point, somebody will be up here, I'll be gone.
As long as we're talking.
Right. No, thanks for bringing all those up.
So I'd like to hear a little bit about the idea of a place that's a place of transit versus a place that to a destination. And the Vaughan Mall has sort of always been a place of transit with no particular location to get to on either end of it. And now it actually seems to start to have those. I mean, with the new hotels and, you know, maybe with the music hall at the other end, you know, there's a reason to transit that, but shouldn't it be maybe a place to be too? So that's the question.
That's going to be a really interesting thing to try to balance in the design process. I've had reason to come down to Portsmouth a few times in the last couple of weeks, and I find that I've been parking over here by 3S because the parking garage has been full because apparently everyone else has decided to come down when I come down. And so we're using it like to go from Flatbread Company over here to the public parking or whatever we may be doing. We found ourselves going through Vaughan Mall, and that does change the relationship. It's good for the businesses because now you have maybe some traffic that you weren't getting before. You still have the parking lot, which is generating some activity. But how do you have people move through the site? Do you let it be like a line of sight that I can just bust through, you know, on my phone mindlessly? Or do I have to navigate through the site? And are there these outdoor rooms where people can gather? I don't know. That's what we want to get from all of you. How do we balance that? But I think just recognizing that it is changing and that you could drive some of that change, make it a place that people are like, well, I'll just walk through Vaughan Mall. It'll be a pleasant way to connect point A to point B.
Yes. What impact will the current shops and bars along the mall itself have on the current plan and going into the future? It's a tangent to what he just asked.
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know if there's someone from PS21 that can answer that. I don't know, Doug. If you have a sense for what the city feels.
I don't think that they have plans for the particular businesses that are there, but I don't know. We have the city councilor here. Who am I?
Hi. So the mayor just appointed a committee to look at not only the Vaughan Mall, but the Worth lot and the Bridge Street lot all together and how they're not only connected with Market Square and like the heart of downtown, but the new parking garage that's going to be coming in and everything that surrounds it. So this is really good timing. However, that committee, I'm here from that committee, so I'm listening and I hope to be there on Saturday as well. But I don't know if this vision is going to be the ultimate vision, so don't get mad at us, but the city is looking at it.
So it sounds like there's an opportunity for us to get some ideas out there so that they can be brought into that process. But the weight of decision-making, we'll have to wait and see.
Another question?
How has your experience been in the past with incorporating in sort of the maintenance issues along with this? And especially in a situation like this where the city would have to be involved in that and you'd have to kind of be inclusive to deal with some of that?
That's a great question. I've dealt with it more on campuses. So a lot of the systems that I've been fortunate enough to work with people on designing and installing have been in campus settings. So Colby Sawyer and Plymouth State, two places that I have a little bit of leverage. And in each place, we started off addressing those maintenance questions with physical plant. the people that were going to be often stuck with the role of maintaining these places, with a couple of exceptions where students are predominantly doing everything. And it's interesting when you look at the existing system and the amount of maintenance that happens versus maybe the change, the design change to a more green infrastructure approach where there's going to be maintenance. There's totally going to be maintenance. But you know what? If we went back to that photo, they're cleaning out those catch basins. They're dealing with falling debris. They're, you know, trying not to kill the trees with the snowplows. Like, there are things that are happening. And so in some cases, we've been able to look at what's going on now and talk about maybe the shift. It might be a different type of maintenance. And even if we aim for low maintenance, it's not going to be no maintenance. So I think also being honest about the type of maintenance that will require, too, at the outset is important and how it might be different. It might be a different skill set.
So to that, I would add that, to a certain extent, the city is committed to helping us with the project. Shortly after the workshop, we have a meeting with Public Works and David Moore, Assistant City Planner, to talk about these kind of issues and for them to go over the plan to see if it meets with local regulations. But they're also providing things to be determined, like mulch and possibly dirt and various other things that could be incorporated in the design.
I was just thinking about the winter and snow and ice and all those things. And, if Vaughan Mall becomes a different scenario, maybe the city would consider not using salt and using old-timey dirt or something like that so that we could actually make a change that would be, you know, more real as opposed to just adding a few plants here and there. So
I would agree. And I think it could also, if you acknowledge some of those impacts, even if right now the sidewalk that's there is going to stay or it's going to be diminished at some point when there's some large capital project that has to happen there, if you've communicated enough what's going on, maybe there's an opportunity at some point when they rip up to replace the storm drain to do some porous pavement or something that takes a lot less material in the winter. So they uses a lot less salt, for instance. Yep.
So if people are proposing less pavement, there should be maybe some cooperation.
And if that's the case, if that's the way things are moving, like towards like a stormwater utility situation where we all take responsibility for the water we generate, what a great place to show different systems you could use, whether you're a business owner or a homeowner. This could really become a place to showcase some more sustainable design methods. Maybe it doesn't happen in May. You know, maybe there's not this great depaving and porous pavement goes down, but maybe there's some initial steps that could happen, like you said, some policy changes, but then eventually it's known that if there is going to be a large capital project in there that we do something different and we use some of the tools.
Just a comment too. I think it was Clyde over there who was talking about making Vaughan Mall a destination, not just a pass-through kind of area. I think when you presented the example of the High Line in New York as an example, that narrow space and all the things that they have done with that narrow alley type of space, I think would work perfectly in Vaughan Mall. So they've got places where people can sit down and relax and lay out in the sun. There's not a whole lot of sun there, but there's performance areas that are set up that you don't necessarily have to use it full time as a performance area. It's also, I don't know, it's very adaptable to just relaxing. But if there's a pop-up performance, it's perfect for that as well. I think that I wish I were going to be here for the workshop this weekend, but I'm not. But I hope that you all consider that type of thing and just use the High Line as a really good example of how to use this narrow type of space.
Thanks for sharing that, because I think there's a lot of inspiration that comes from examples of places that you've all been. That is a place I took my kids on vacation.
Just to piggyback on that, I was here, I'm not sure when, a few months ago when they had that PS21 had the placemaking workshop, and there was a movie at that time that was great that had ideas about how to make places where people like to stay and what to look for in the design. So, yeah, that was great. So maybe some of those ideas could be incorporated.
Right, and the movie is The Social Life of Small Urban Spaces, which is, and there's a link to it off of our homepage on the website. You can watch it online. It's a great old movie from 1970-75. People love that movie, though. It's great. More questions?
Just a comment based on that. I think that's one of the things that makes your process so intriguing, is that you're taking inspiration from all of these different design approaches and all of these different practices, and you're trying to weave them together into something that represents Portsmouth. So you're not just taking one thing and jumping onto it.
There was a question over here. Coming.
Hey, I was wondering if you had any advice for people who are looking to begin growing food on their property, like any like good places to start or like successes, failures that you had.
Yeah, I think one of the first things is just to spend a little time observing your site, like seeing what the conditions are like on that spot that you're thinking about growing food, what kind of sunlight it gets, how water moves across the site seasonally, how it may be different at times of year. And granted, you might be ready to like start planting the end of next month and you can't do a ton of observation, then maybe just don't bite off the whole site, but bite off a section of it and know that you're going to observe through the growing season. And if you don't have 100% success with what you're going after, you're going to be learning and then the next year it'll get better. But give yourself that time. We started on a really small part of our property because we didn't know it that well. And it was amazing how much we learned about the site over a couple of years, but it definitely took some time. And also, we shook things up a little bit. You know, some of our first food production was actually out front, which you would think would alienate neighbors. But it actually really intrigued neighbors and got other people to start thinking about what the best place on their site was, not just like that it has to be in the backyard. Like it's shameful to grow food. Right. Somehow that's happened culturally, right? We have to hide our food production. So that's one thing I can tell you. There are some great resources, and I'm going to stick around. I'm happy to share some resources with folks. And invite people over who have some experience. You know, they're often very happy to share.
Okay. So we should probably wrap it up.
Sounds good, Doug.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Steve Whitman. So if you are interested in the workshop, and we hope you are, you can sign up at the desk out in the lobby. That's this Saturday from 10 to 4. It'll be at Discover Portsmouth Center. It should be really interesting. Thanks a lot. Okay. Thank you.